Allow me to introduce our speaker. Liu Jinlong is professor and director of the Center of Forestry, Environmental, and Resource Policy Study at Renmin University of China. He received his PhD in Rural Development Sociology in 2006 from the Wageningen University in the Netherlands. Dr. Liu is honorable adjunct professor at Hong Kong University and adjunct professor at Wageningen University in Seoul National University. His research fields include rural development, forest and environmental governance and policy, natural resource management. Jinlong also is a deputy coordinator of the IUFRO Forest Policy and Economics in Division 9 and a member of the Task Force of Indigenous and Local Knowledge of the International Science Policy Forum on Biodiversity Ecosystem. He's published over 100 journal articles and 4 academic books since 2010. On that note, I'm going to turn over the screen to him, and I'm going to hide myself out so you can't see me.
Okay. Let me show the my slides.
Good. We can see them.
Yes. Okay. Then start from now. Thanks, James. Good morning and good evening and good afternoon, dear friend. And it's my pleasure to give this virtual presentation. I'm going to talk about the history strategy of the China land timber forest products, as well as experience gain, lesson learned, and challenge faced, and the way forward. After reform and the 1980s, China forest sector was received a large amount of foreign aid, especially in technology investment, and also forest management, such as land timber forest products. As China contemporary forest development idea, policy, and governance has been deeply influenced by the world. In 2000, there are few published journal articles on land timber forest product concept and its application to China development. And this concept has entered the decision-making process and now form part of the country forest vision. However, the China Forest Authority has traditionally focused on wood production in the major mandate. Since the beginning of this century, the Forest Authority has placed ecological protection as the main goal, but non-timber forest products has never been set in a central government official policy document. Although non-timber forest products has not been set directly, similar terminology has been used in China forest authority policy documentation, such as forest sideline products and the planting economy and the payment of ecological products. That's the last term, you know, it's very vague term widespread adoption in China in recent years. Today, I'm going to illustrate some example of these concepts from some cases. I will discuss what we have gained and what we have learned and the challenges we face and how to move forward. I'm going to talk today. China actually is a big country across the tropical, subtropical, and temperate zone. China is also the multi-ethnic countries with 1,000 years of agricultural civilization. And a large proportion of population live in the forest and the mountain region, which is home to rich and diverse agricultural civilization. And so tree and forest are important part of local livelihood. Non-timber forest products are not just products, but also in dispensable part of the local social-ecological system. Many non-timber forest products, such as umbrella, rice paper, town oil ingrained in the local culture, custom, emotion, and spirit. There is no collective term for collecting and farming trees and forests. However, we refer to the product as traditional forest-related knowledge and a product for self-sufficient economy. Forests and trees provide fuel, food, medicine, and all other kind of necessities. China has a very rich in this regard, actually. Many forest-related products has a particular spiritual and cultural meaning or heritage value associated with particular community and people. There is a saying in subtropical East China, better eat without meat than live without bamboo, which means people are happy to be poor, live with a forest, even in extremely poor. Of course, bamboo stands can provide material for housing, for trees, meats, and beautiful landscapes. Due to the particular value, if you visit China, you will see many smaller gardens full of small bamboo stands, especially in Shanghai, Jiangsu, and Zhejiang province. The China introduced forest science in 1930s, and most of first generation of forest scientists actually studied in the USA. After graduation, they come back to China and established forest college and formal government authorities. Actually, we are very similar to the United States system, forest governmental system. After the Communist Party take power and socialism established, the forest sector continued to only improve timber production in a similar way to many other developing countries. In order to combat wood production, it was separate from the local social ecosystem. China created the new term called forest sideline products or forest byproducts to group other products with economic value. The economic value in practice refers to produce that can be sold to the different marketplace, in particular international markets. There are hundreds of, even thousands of forest byproducts, mainly divided into seven categories. The first category is food and oil products, mainly include chestnuts, walnuts, jujuba, jingu, whatever, etc. There are many, many kinds of this kind of products. And the resin, lacquer, and the wax, such as cypress, tan oil, and a lacquer tree, and the resins. And the forest spices include essential oil produced from chicken paper and trees. And forest drinks, most common are sepa song and Chinese kiwi and a blueberry. And edible fungi, and the mountain edible herbs such as agaric and berutas. And the medicine plants such as ginseng or American ginseng. That American ginseng is introduced actually to China. And the forage plants for animals. The tech example, few examples. Actually, today I want to take the two examples of that. One is a forest sideline protest. One is one of the famous native forests is tan oil. The tan oil tree is commonplace in South China, stand longly on the edge of forest and the roadside in hilly areas and require humid conditions. According to archaeological and documentary record, the use of tan oil can be traced back to Sui and the Tang Dynasty around 1,400 years ago. In the Song Dynasty, about 1,000 years ago, tang trees was planted on a large scale. And the tang tree were widely used in the production of tang oil commodities. The government set tang oil as that time in the Song Dynasty, the government set tang oil as a position of secretary. The tang oil produced in one county called Yongshu County, Hunan Province, was used as a tribute to the emperor. The the Qin Dynasty, once example, taxation on a town or your products promote development town or your industries. From the famous town oil production area in West Hunan and sold to the local market north of Yangtze River. At the end of Qin Dynasty, town oil started to recognize by international market, such as Japan, British, or United States, and town oil export to the world. Traditionally, town oil used in the furniture. The photo on the left shows it takes Chinese food as a background color and does not reason and reason once, reason second, and reason fourth, you know, the third then color become brighter and brightest. The tan oil can prevent corrosion and worms. And the picture at the top right and is existing traditional processing, the machine, you know, machines. The lower right, the photo shows town oil furniture. It's really nice. When I was very young, that is, you know, if the rich family has that sort of, you know, furniture. Another additional use of town oil is make umbrella. The photo on the left, the top left, depict umbrella making. The bottom left is a traditional town oil umbrella. As a childhood, when I was a child, actually I often used tan oil umbrella. The umbrella was actually made of bamboo. It was very bulky and inconvenient to carry. This ancient, the modern umbrella of tan oil on the top right is replaced by metal, and the clothes replaced by light and thin, fine imitation clothes. Very recently, many manufacturers has developed professional tan oil color umbrella and chain umbrella clothes into color clothes, you know. The total tan oil production is about 400,000 tons a year. The tan tree has been introduced to North America, Europe, and Japan from a certain production capacity. But 80% of the production, global production, is concentrated in China, but only around 6,000 tons was exported. Its industry has been impacted by the painting chemical technology products of first line developing countries such as Germany, which has great compressed China market space, and umbrella. The manufacturing technology has been replaced by the light and the small and the portable umbrella. Actually, that is invented by Japanese. But tan oil has still maintained its variability, and it is all for natural, traditional, environment friendly. Another, you know, the example is a resin. Resin is another important antimicrobial products in China. The use of resin is lighting. For lighting can be traced back to the Tang Dynasty, that is 1,400 years ago, which is a history. However, the resin as an important industry raw material begins in the early 20th centuries. It can be seen from the picture, in the picture from the photos. For that resin collection require a modern technology. And the technology requirement for pine plantation management and resin collection are relatively high. Resin can be widely used in the paper making, printing, food, and domestic, and many other industries. In the 20th century, the wood resin production increased continuously in China. In the last 30 years, global resin production remained between 1 million to 1.1 million tons. In 1908, the output of resin in the United States actually reached to very close to 500,000 tons. Since 1980s, the production of resin in developed country has decreased very sharply. The production of resin in United States has gradually decreased from 500,000 tons in 1950s to 240 40,000 tons in 2000 and further decreased to less than 200,000 tons in 2001. The highest annual output raised in China was 16,000 tons in 1936. That is the first half of the centuries. But after Communist Party take power, that actually start to increase to the 280,000 tons in 1980s, and increased to 400,000 tons at the beginning of the century, and decreased reached to 1.5 million tons in 2015, and then decreased year by year. The deprocessing capacity of raisin production in China continued to increase. In the 1990s, the annual export volume of raisin was as high as 130 to 150 million US dollars. At that time, it's very, very important to China foreign exchange income. Therefore, the central government decided to establish the called China Jinlong Raisin Group. Jinlong actually is also my name, given name, which is special, a very special responsibility for the international trade of this organization, the responsible for this international trade. After China and into the WTO, Germany, France, and America enterprise, they start to establish the deep processing and finishing products, enterprise in China raisin produce area, which has promoted development of China raisin industry so far. So far, the deep processed raisin in China is mainly dominated by the enterprise from these developed countries. After 2006, China export of raisin raw material decreased sharply from 300,000 50 tons per year to 50,000 tons in 2018. Actually, in that year, China export import of raisin raw material exceed the export. We mainly import from Indonesia, the Southeast Asia countries. Another story actually we like to talk is Jingu Biloba. This is also interesting story. Jingu Biloba is a native tree species to China. It is now cultivated all over the world and is common in parks. Jingu Biloba also has a long cultivated history in China. There are more than 1,000 years of cultivated trees still alive. These beauty golden color trees can often seen in China, particularly in autumn. The fruit is also delicious, and the leaf has actually in China spirit meaning. As they you see, photo shoot that when they form the shape of the hand fan. Since China joined the WTO at the beginning of this century, the pharmaceutical factory in France and Germany has brought Jingu Biloba leaf, in China, and the extracted from this leaf can be used as raw material in certain type of medicine, such as expanding, coronary vessel, it's for brother, illness. And decrease in the blood volume, improve the cardio cerebral function, and reduce steroids. In 2005, China built Jingu leaf extraction and processing plant all around the Yangtze River. They created a large area of the Jingu plantations. Many price actually the closed down before they were built because too much, because the price of exact purchased by France and Germany enterprise fall very sharply. So some enterprise turned to develop, actually they tried another market and the Jingu Biloba leaf tea or other processed drinks. Actually, it is, formed a certain market in China now. And we see implementation of natural forest protection program and a logging ban in China, and the canopy economy has become an important way for state-owned enterprise for in the forest region or to explore alternative income sources since 2004. Our former prime minister actually visited Fushan Prefecture in the Liaoning Province, Northeast China in February 2007. He said it's very important to protect the ecological environment and develop and the canopy economy. That it was the first time the Chinese, the top leader has mentioned the under canopy economy concept. But actually the under canopy economy was first highlighted in a policy document of forest authority in 2012. That is due to the implementation of collective forest right reform. Collective forests were privatized, but there were poor economic incentive to manage forests. The forest authority enact a policy instrument and attempt to promote economic activity under forest. This activity include farming or animal raising under forest, collecting wild products from the forest and ecotourism. To some extent, in my my interpretation of under canopy economy is it's much closer to the forest based agroforestry plus traditional use of the wild stuff and promote ecotourism. The slides they also show under canopy planting Chinese medicine or the mushroom or some sorghum that is in the planting. There are a lot of models, and then also show canopy animal raising like bean keeping, like grazing under forest. The payment to ecological protection actually is very new policy terminology, highlighted by the very top level China policy document issued by the State Reform and Reform Committee. This agency in China is a very powerful agency, actually, much higher than forest authority. In China, we call State Forestry and Pastoral Administration. This term is much similar to the bioeconomy in terms of connotation. So far, we do not know what will happen on the ground and how sectors like relate to the the social ecological service include forest, marine, wetland, grassland, how to come to implement the ideologies. It requires more time to understand the impact on the forest. And the term is characterized by the systematic, holistic, integrated, non-timber forest products will be part of forest management, but it's not clear what kind of policy and institutional regimen will be formed to promote it. It gives individual, the private sector, and a non-government organization as imaginary space, which need coordination from local government to enable increased participation from different sector, different stakeholders. I personally believe that this term will require framework that need to be realized by the local government. Non-timber forest products will unlike to be the focus, I think, but ecological restoration, physical policy, ecological compensation, and carbon sequestration will become the core. In order to do comparison among the different terms, I made another category of approach for forest products and service excluded forest timber products. One is a non-timber products collected from natural forest, and the second is non-timber forest products harvested from plantation. The third one is forest service, including ecotourism, supply of clean water, carbon sequestration. And the last, the category is forest spiritual, cultural, heritage value, like holly tree and forest. And then I make the table the table, I think you can show, you know, connotation actually the different among these five terms. They have different focus. Non-timber forest products, I think more attention to collecting in natural forest and less so on collecting from the, you know, the plantation and, you know, also little, the ecotourism. The products from the forest-related traditional knowledge, I think, include everything, but focused on collecting natural forest and the cultural heritage values. And the plantation sideline products focus on collecting and harvest from natural forest and the plantations. And the economy and the planting economy focused on collecting harvest from plantation has a moderate focus on collecting from natural forest and a little focus on the forest ecological service, ecotourism, you know. The payment for ecological products, I say, is included all these four categories. I have some few remarks on non-timber forest products, you know, historic strategies. China forest natural, non-timber forest policy direct attached great importance to production, not to the commerce, not to the market, you know, it's a little bit different with, you know, other countries. Expanding the production capacity of products and the production efficiency per unit, per the land areas. That is related to China basic national conditions. We have a long history of development and the scales land relative to the population size. And the reality of scarcity forest resource in China determine that the shortage of non-timber forest products related to the demand. That is linked to the delineation of natural non-timber forest products in local market and rely on customer regulation. The under canopy economy has become the main policy proposition of forest development, which reflect that idea, push it to that extreme. This is also leads to beyond recovery capacity of natural ecosystem, leading to degradation of ecosystem quality, such as water pollution and the soil pollution of under canopy agriculture and the soil remediation of under canopy plantings. The processing, marketing, and value chain of most non-timber forest products are deeply affected by the self-sufficient economy. Over the past century, China society has experienced two different periods of planned economy and a market economy. However, the processing and trade of non-timber forest products has always been rooted in the natural economy. Under the influence of globalization, the few Chinese non-timber products processing the sale chain has changed from serving to the local market, based on the informal role to the customer in field trade. Formal institutional such as formal enterprise standardization and specialization to serve a global market. Since the reform and open up China market demand, expansion capacity, industry equipment capacity, and the basic scientific research capacity has risen, shaping and reshaping the industry chain and value chain non-timber forest products. The great majority of non-timber forest products still, you know, stay in the production line link and rely on self-sufficient exchange gifts and informal market. The value of non-timber forest products in China economy is seriously underestimated. Once recognized by the remote market, it's very easy for the high-end market to enjoy the bubble economy, such as orchid jingle. It's easy to be grafted into the traditional informal system to be able, informal market, even lead to deformity of industrial chain of non-timber forest products, especially on the demand side. Okay. very few, you know, important non-timber forest products are recognized by the market so far. Rely on the, you know, still a lot of rely on, you know, rely on the gift economy, which include high-end products that prolong life and eliminating and prevent diseases. China is very, you know, very interesting, very happy to, you know, if the products have some health functions, China people, Chinese people are very love to enjoy this in products, kind of products, like, you know, pine, pollen, you know, ginseng, camellia oil, you know, these are products. The market play a diverse, very deceptive role in developing development of China non-timber forest products. In this development process, the focus on efficiency has been very obvious. Yes. I have four suggestions actually for the future development of China non-timber forest products. The first, empower the traditional community and local institutions and enhance the financial support, which may be required by developing, you know, the non-timber forest products. And secondly, appreciate normative framework needs to be developed, including that or the national legislation, you know, to recognize non-timber forest products, and the policy documents, you know, also recognize non-timber forest products, and the standardize of non-timber forest products, and promote integrate, you know, firstly, you have to recognize the importance of traditional knowledge and promote the integration of scientific knowledge and the forest traditional knowledge. And lastly, but not least, strengthen the voice of the local people throughout the policy making process and enhance the decentralization process. Thank you for your listening, and I welcome any question you may have. Thank you very much. That's the end of my presentation.
Thank you, Jinlong. Very interesting. We do have a couple questions, and I'm going to come back to some of your slides later. So let's try to keep those available. A couple questions have come up. First of all, Steve would like to know about the collective forests. Who owns the collective forests and who is in charge? Can you speak a little bit about the ownership and the governance of that?
Okay, you know, after, you know, the China Communist Party take power in China, we reclaim the land, you know, claim the land as the collective land, not private. Used to be private land, but we call it commune land or collective land. But after China opened up, so, you know, we introduced the household responsibility system. That means, okay, you, the farmer, individual household, you can manage the land. You own the use right of the land, but not ownership of the land. But forest sector, actually, in the 1980s, 1983 or 1982, we copied that policy from agriculture to allocate a certain amount of collective forest to individual household. But it's not, it's not very in depth, you know. There's still, you know, there are many collective forests still maintained as collective forest, not you know, contract to individual household. So in 2003 and 2008, we have the new round of the collective forest tenure reform. That means require more than 95% of collective forest has to be contract out to the individual household. That means the individual household could have the ownership of the forest, that is private ownership of forest, but not private ownership of the land. You can have own the use rights of the land. So that's you know, collective forest, but actually collective land plus private forest in China. Over 63% of the forest in China that is that term.
Very interesting. Very good. Another question that arose. Mac asks, You spoke of this, a new initiative that's going on, and he was curious, are bamboo forests part of that new initiative?
Yes, of course, of course.
And you know, how do they fit into that?
I'm quite familiar with the bamboo, you know, the bamboo industry in China. Bamboo, you know, they are large area in China, particularly South China, the bamboo forest. Why China has so large area of bamboo? It's a very interesting story, actually, you know, very interesting story. Because, you know, as I mentioned already, you know, the collective forest still, you know, the collective still have some forest that owned by a collective. But bamboo traditionally is owned by the individual household. So in some place, in particularly South China, the private land, if it's suitable for bamboo plantation, actually the farmer like to have bamboo plantation. And the bamboo is you know, they can harvest every 2 years. They can have one harvest. And they can also collect, you know, bamboo shoots as a food. So bamboo is also high values. So the bamboo stands everywhere in South China, and very high, you know, used to be, you know, very economic, you know, very good economic return. But the James, you know, recent 10 years, the labor cost in China increased very fast, and the population, you know, the depopulation in rural areas is very serious, you know, more than in some area, in a particular, you know, in the rich areas, more than half of farmers, actually they immigrate out to the cities. So the urban, the rural area living, you know, the elders or the children or women, you know, the you know, the laborers, they like to, you know, work in the sea coast regions, you know. So that one reason is the lack of the labor in the forest region, in bamboo regions. So the harvest cost is very serious. So recently, you know, it's the problem. So how to recover the bamboo industries? So it's a headache for many, you know, local government. But I still think, you know, because the bamboo, we have to use the hand to harvest bamboo. That is a problem because it's hilly, you know, hilly areas. So I think in the future, if we develop a kind of machine to harvest bamboo, then we solve that problem, labor problem. They may contribute to the, you know, accelerate the bamboo, you know, industries. So we actually very recently the central government issued the policy document how to support bamboo, the prospective of the bamboo industries. So I'm not sure, you know, I involved in a debate on the policy document. Before they issued the document, I was asked to give advice to call for the meeting. I gave some of my advice. You know, I think you have to rely on the market. The government can do something or provide some incentive or the, you know, some research and funding for machine, but you have to rely on the economy, on the private sectors. How to manage, you know, how to make, you know, economic, you know, better, you know, economic returns.
We have a couple more questions. Gene asks, we were talking about forest restoration, and Gene was wondering, do you use non-timber forest products in efforts to restore forests? And he goes on to ask, how do you manage land use now in China? So two-sided questions. One, are you using non-timber forest products in forest restoration? And then what is the sort of driving force on managing land use in China?
The first question, I'm not sure. You know, according to my eyes, we have quite confusing, you know, opinion in terms on the non-timber forest, you know, production in China. The some ecological, you know, ecologists that state, you know, they care very careful environment protection. That side, the scientists said it's not good because, you know, forest is forest, and you know, the you know, that's natural, you know. You cannot, you know, do some, you know, plantation or the farming on under the forest. Then, you know, destroy the environment, you know, the forest, the soil, whatever they say, you know? Particularly against by the agriculture sector, you know, like, you know, whatever the kind of agriculture products, actually China is managed by the Minister of Agriculture and Rural Affairs. It's not managed by the forest sector. Forest sector is timber oriented or ecological protection, you know. So they have the fighting between between these two authorities. The other side, actually, you know, if they don't do non-timber forest, you know, the farmer do not have interest to private sector do not have interest to involve in the forest restoration. The forest restoration, okay, we require the private sector to step in, but the private sector, they require economic return. If we don't allow, how they are interested, then only rely on the subsidy from the government or the invest from the government. That is not, you know, so I think they're very different views. From my eyes, I visited many places in China. From my eyes, I think non-timber forest products hasn't yet included for the you know, forest restoration initiative. Not yet. They don't think that way. The second, you know, question is a very big question, actually, the drivers. We try to do studies in my team. I think it's not easy questions. The driver for China forest, you know, afforestation, whatever, with forest, you know, rehabilitation or forest, forest cover increase. I think obviously it said, okay, that is government, each of the policy, the private, they invest a lot of money for afforestation and forest management. But according to our research team, I think they're a little bit comprehensive. You know, the driver is because, you know, the population in the rural area is major drivers. Because the population in the rural area that decline, so the requirement for fuel wood is declined very rapidly. You know, why the forest is degraded? Because the farmer require the fuel wood. But now that a large proportion of the rural population, the immigrant to the earth, they use the coal, the gas, the electricity, not use the fuel wood anymore. So I think the fuel wood demand decline, depopulation of rural area, and as well as, you know, because the China environment is not so good due to the high population, quite poor for a long time. So the environment is not so good. I visit many countries too, you know, visit many countries, I can do my comparison with my eyes. I think China, environment, particular forest, you know, environment, it's still a problem. So the central government are keen to improve the quality of forest. But other problem related, because we have a very large, you know, proportion of plantations. Plantation require some, you know, intervention, human intervention. Otherwise, you know, it's very density. One species or few species, if you do not do thinning or clean, you know, thinning, then the forest will not become forest. They will very congested, so it's a problem. I'm not sure, you know. So I think the drivers of the forest cover increase in China is a very complicated issue. And definitely in some area, like in a farm area, lack of forest, lack of timber is a drivers. Because lack of timber, the farmer, you know, plant some tree in somewhere, marginalized land, and you know, it's come up forest. So it's complicated. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we've got a bunch more questions, and we're running low on time. So let me try to get through this. Robert Healy asks, "What percent of total land area is in forest in China?"
China, 23%.
23%.
A little bit more than 23%.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Thank you. And let me go back to Emily. Emily has a question about sustainability certification. And what role do you see for sustainability certification in development of international NTFP trade from China? So the question revolves around sustainability certification.
Yes. Yes, actually, you know, that certification, you know, standardized, sustained, national standards of the certificate 19 forest products, actually is supported by the FSC, supported by international donors, But I think, you know, it's very little impact on China, very little impact. It's not well implemented. I think, as I already mentioned, China's term is, you know, the change, the shift. Okay, we're satellite products. The term is still used. And then we have, you know, called underplanting, under canopy plant economy, or now we have the, you know, payment to ecological products. So the confusing. So then timber forest products is not very popular in the policy document. So it's not very, you know, implemented. It's not good implemented. Yeah.
Thank you very much. So moving on, we've got, you were talking about empowering traditional communities and traditional knowledge. And the question is, apart from financial support, how and what can be done to help empower traditional communities? What other things can we do? Besides providing financial support?
You know, it's a face by face. I think, you know, at around 2000, China government has very, very low capacity to provide funding to the poor communities in the west part of China, mostly in hilly or mountainous regions. In the ecological fragile regions. So that times rely on the civil societies, the non-government organization. The non-government organization, the large proportion of funding actually is from international aid, from international communities, you know, for poverty alleviation, for whatever the purpose, you know. So they support community, empower community providing some funding to support local community to do some, you know, whatever they like, including, okay, promote non-timber forest products, or including, you know, protect the traditional knowledge, forest related knowledge, you know. But if we look at now, China, in the last 10 years, actually China, the physical account or the government budget increased very, very fast, increased, you know, I think, double, something like this, you know. So, and the central government actually transferred large amount of money to the west part of China, poor underdeveloped regions for develop, for poverty alleviation, for whatever the purpose, for infrastructure, you know. James, if you come to, you know, visit the west part of China, it's changed a lot, you know. Used to be very remote, very hard to access, but now they have highway, you know. And provide a lot of funding for poverty alleviation. So I think, so if government, you know, create the space, okay, certain amount of funding, we can direct it to the collective, to the community, the traditional communities. They can manage, they can use, they can, okay, develop by whatever they like. I think it also empower, you know, themselves. Because you know, relatively there are lack of capacity anyway, you know, we need to support them as well, including financial support. Without finance, they cannot do anything, you know. So that is why, you know, in the past 20 years, if you look at non-timber forest products, bubble economy, whatever you call it, you know, social chaos related to the development of non-timber forest products, it's because the community, the local people, they don't have capacity to against or finance, including financial capacity to against the middleman, including, you know, buyer from far away, from maybe from Guangdong, from Shanghai, you know, they're rich, the collected, they buy in the market, just buy and sell. So the lot of money actually, perfect for these people, outside people, not community. So I think, you know, my recommendation to Chinese government. We need to create space for local community in the West Park China, for there to access to the funding, including access to the infrastructure. Project. They can manage their project. To develop infrastructure. That's already actually very recently the Chinese central government issued that policy to they call support. Support cooperative support, or some community-based organization, whatever they call something like that. Thank you.
So we go moving on. Bharat asks about ecotourism. Do you consider is ecotourism considered a non-timber forest products? How do you look at that?
This is something related, because if we promote the ecotourism, that means we attract lots of visitors. Then non-timber forest products, they can sell to these visitors. So usually the ecotourism is not just ask them to stay or leave to enjoy, but also sell the local products. To show up, local foods. So that's actually it's integrated. It is integrated.
I think you raise a good point. The non-timber forest product sort of attracts people to a tourist activity.
Yes, yes.
And I think particularly in the culinary sector.
Yes, yes.
I've talked to colleagues around the world, and it seems like that's very true. So maybe ecotourism may not be considered a product, but the product itself and through ecotourism kind of attracts people to the local places.
Yes, yes.
That's a really good perspective. Yep. Let me see. We've got a few more minutes. Mac asks a little bit more information about the number of people who are involved in making a living on forest resources and how many hectares that are involved. So I guess looking at rural households and people who are directly involved in supporting their living through the forests.
It's a good question, but also it's a very hard question. We have statistics, official statistics, something like, 10 million the people rely on forest in China or rely on the non-timber forest in China, it's something like that way, also the very huge amount of the money, create. Generate from the non-timber forest, they also called under canopy economies, less than trillion, maybe $100 million, something like that. That's huge amount. But I don't believe that. But I don't believe that. I think it's we need to do some survey because some overestimated. It's not the non-timber forest products, or maybe but maybe according to their category, like under canopy plant economy, they can include maybe the processing, processing of these products, and then maybe processing is not from the under canopy, but it's from plantations, the pure plantations. The nuts, whatever they're called, So I think, we have to be, it's quite risk to say, that this number, that number, we have official data, we have official, data, but that data, I don't think it's, I have some doubt. But I'm not, that's my question. That's my answer.
One other quick question. We've got to move on because we're running low on time. So William asks the question, if ginkgo if ginkgo is cultivated in plantations, why is it classified as a non-timber forest product? And can you comment on that?
Actually, ginkgo is not good species for plantation, for the trees living in the plant together, in the pure plantation. The ginkgo actually is one tree. If we plant one tree and another one tree, it will be grow very well. But if we plant together, it's not good. It's not good. So actually, in China, the ginkgo is a kind of separate trees planted in somewhere, home garden or the park or whatever. Yeah. So I know that is also why I'm really quite doubt the number given, official number, official data provided by authorities, because I think the large proportion of the products they calculate maybe from pure plantations, not from whatever we call collected or something. It's kind of I'm not sure how to say that. It's confusing. It's planted one tree mixed with other tree, we can call it non-timber forest. But how if they one hectare, maybe 10 hectare, or okay, then 100 hectare. I'm not sure. How to divide it. Now that is non-timber forest, that is the cash crop trees, cash crop economy, whatever they call. Yeah.
I would interject there, because I would suggest if a tree is grown in a plantation, it's still a forest product.
Yes.
If a tree is harvested from a natural population, it's a forest product. If a tree is grown and harvested from a plantation, it's still a forest product. So why do we take non-timber products out of that definition if they are cultivated and if they're grown in plantations? And with that, we're going to have to bring this to a close. Jinlong, thank you very much for the excellent presentation.